Hi, I'm Steph Brennan, Hockey for Heroes coach, and welcome to a series of podcasts designed to give you chunks of information to fuel your thoughts and take back to your coaching environments. The first, which I would like to share with you, is all about interacting with your players and how we can get more from your athletes. I'll be talking to you about a small chunk of theory that underpins the practical tips for you to then take away and explore. The theory that I would be talking to you guys about today is all to do with the process of us taking in information and using the skills and knowledge that we need, not only in sport, but in all areas of life when we learn to do something. And this process is called encoding, storage, and retrieval. Now, encoding is where we initially take in the information, and it can be taken in visually or through listening, through semantics, where information has a meaning to us, and through elaborating a knowledge that we already have. For example, we've already got the pre-existing knowledge of how to make a tea or coffee, but it's just a case of taking in that extra information of how your colleagues or your family like to take their tea or their coffee. Next, we have the storage of this information in our memory. Now, this is completely dependent on how meaningful that information is to us, and that depends on whether it is then stored in our short-term memory or our long-term memories. For example, I could ask you what you had for lunch today and you could probably tell me, but in a week's time, you probably won't be able to. And that's because that doesn't mean that much to us. That information isn't necessary for us to retain. Our challenge as coaches, however, is to get our players to store the information that we give them in their long-term memories. And hopefully the practical tips I'm going to give you as we go through this will help make that information more meaningful and therefore stored in that long-term memory bank that they have. Finally, we have the retrieval process. This is where we pick out the relevant information that we have stored for a situation that we're currently in, and then we then apply it. The more meaningful our memories are here, the more likely we are to pull out the relevant information and use it in the correct scenario. And the more we repeat this, the more diverse our application of knowledge can be. So if we think about the first time you learnt a skill, and your performance would probably be quite inconsistent at this time, because you'd be missing out some of the key technical parts. Whereas now you've learnt that skill, and the skill has been encoded, stored, and retrieved a number of times, you're probably at the point where you can use that skill in quite a variety of different situations. And that's because it's then been stored into your long-term memory. So how can our interactions with players help develop this process? The practical tips I'm going to give you are in no way exhaustive, but could be a good start for getting your players to think a little bit deeper and create more meaningful memories of the things that you're coaching them. And hopefully they will then be able to apply that in situations that we want them to be successful in. These practical tips are just a few ways which might help the learning of your players, and they're all centred around how we communicate with them. So the first of my practical tips is to try and open your style of questioning. I spent a long time convinced that my players were learning because they were able to regurgitate Bud's words back to me, but then it completely baffled me and I was getting increasingly frustrated when it then wouldn't translate back into their performances. By opening our questions and using a language such as using words like explain why, or tell me how this happened, or describe what this meant, it gets our players to think a little bit deeper beyond the surface of the content we're coaching them and gets them to reflect on the application of knowledge they're learning and creating that more meaning behind why we're coaching them what we are. It also gives them more of a story or a narrative that has a bit more depth for them to remember in your future sessions. Using language like, do you remember when we did this, gets them to think back into that long-term memory bank and retrieve the knowledge that they need, and going through that process of encoding, storage, and retrieval. Secondly, priming your players is an excellent way to prepare them for learning. We do our best work in places that we feel safe and where we feel comfortable. So by priming our players with the type of questions we're going to be asking them and how we're going to ask those questions just makes players feel a little bit safer in your session and like there's no nasty surprises heading their way. This way they can focus more on the content that you're delivering and not on the social situation of potentially being picked on or having to respond to questions that require a little bit more thinking. We as coaches and players tend to be working towards the same goals, so it just makes perfect sense to be really upfront about the practical side to your delivery and how you're going to question them. As I'm priming my players, I'll also tell them I'm going to give them some time to think and I'm not expecting immediate responses to answers. On average, once we've asked a question, we engage with a response or rephrase the question to lead them to an answer after around 1 or 2 seconds of waiting, which, if you want them to be delving into their long-term memories, just isn't enough time for a well-thought-out response. And really, if your question can be answered after 1 second, how good is your question? Are you really asking them to go through a deep, thoughtful process? And is it really challenging our players? So increasing your waiting time after asking a question and embracing that awkward silence is one of the biggest changes that I've made to my delivery, and it's had great effects. And with a bit of priming and with a bit of consistent waiting longer when you've asked a question, it really doesn't feel quite so awkward, and you can get some really, really good discussions going on with your players. So another method of questioning to help players get to a deeper level of thinking is one called cold calling. Now, I must take this opportunity to emphasise that using this method should really be done with a group which has a really healthy, good and established relationships between both yourself, the players and the group as a whole. I would also make sure that you let your players know that this is the method of questioning that you're going to be using in parts of your session. Priming will help keep that safe environment that you've created within your group and help people access the questions and get the responses that you want. So cold calling is where we choose people to answer our questions. Now, cold calling sounds really negative, but actually it can be a great facilitator of getting voices which are not normally heard in sessions to be present and sharing. It can also help with maintaining engagement with players in your sessions, as players don't want to have that awkward situation of where they're not listening and they don't know what's going on. We've all been there, and this is one way of avoiding it. So this type of questioning might be something to use with some of your younger players who maybe need a little bit more focus in their sessions. You'll have many active brains with a variety of different stages of learning, thoughts and ideas within your sessions, and this can be a great way of sharing those. Just please, please use with caution, and only when you have a really well-established, healthy team dynamic, or else it could have a really damaging effect on some of your players and how they feel within your sessions. The last practical tip is to try and build relationships with your players to make a really, really supportive space for them to come and learn in. By showing ourselves in a way that puts us working alongside the players, explaining why we're doing what we're doing, can really help players buy into the process of learning. And then when we're doing our Q&A sessions, having a set of ground rules, which can include very basic things like not being talked over and keeping eye contact with the person we're talking, can really help make players feel a little bit more comfortable about sharing their ideas and addressing areas which they may find challenging at that time. Also, by adding value to players' thoughts by using language when we're talking to them, like, we want to hear what your thoughts are, and reinforcing the idea that we're working together as both coach and players to learn and come up with solutions to reach our best levels of performance, we can make a really, really supportive climate for both players and coaches to get the most out of one another, which is ultimately what we want in order to be successful as a group. So I hope that you found all of this interesting and give you a bit of food for thought on what you can do to help get more out of your athletes once we eventually get back out onto the pitch. If you'd like some more information on this and other topics within the world of coaching, check out my Instagram page and my Twitter pages at SJB Coaching.